Thank you very much for your invitation to speak in this colloquium and to start with this extremely difficult problem of consciousness. I will try to do my best to do justice to this difficult topic, but since you were asking for strong statements, I will try to make a strong statement. I hope this will work. Yes. So, and this is based on a review which is available on the table here. Several points. First of all, I think we are beginning to understand what it means for a brain to be conscious. And I would like to show you some data just as examples. There is a lot of activity in neuroscience these days and also cognitive science to try to understand what we mean by the term consciousness and how it works in the brain. And I would like to argue that this is no longer a mystery, it's just a question, a scientific question. And the second point I would like to bring is that I think this view of consciousness that arises from this analysis in cognitive neuroscience is a view where consciousness is seen as a computational property associated with a certain type and level of information processing, and therefore I think there is no theoretical obstacle to its implementation in machines. I think we are not there yet. I don't think there is any machine which is conscious at the moment, but I think it's not impossible. And I would like to argue that there are several levels. Obviously, current algorithms by default are unconscious, but there is the possibility of adding conscious access where a piece of information is amplified and processed. I will describe that. And self-representation in machine, one domain which is less studied in cognitive science, but it's starting to be studied. And with these two levels, I think we have two different axes or meanings of the word consciousness. So I'll start with the first point. I describe in a book also called Consciousness and the Brain. I think we have a lot of data, in fact, and studies at the moment about consciousness. Yeah, we can start the video to give an example, if you have time for a demonstration, of the manipulation of consciousness in the lab. If you fixate the white dot, and you have to keep your eyes on the white dot, okay, don't move your eyes, then you might see that the yellow dots disappear. Do you see that? Sometimes they will just go away. And maybe one of them will go away, two of them, or three of them. Each of you has a subjective experience, but notice that this subjective experience can be manipulated. We all share the same illusion, and this illusion can be studied in the lab. It's just one example of an illusion that we can bring to the lab and analyze, for instance, with brain imaging, what happens to the representation of the yellow dot as, of course, it is always present in your retina and, in fact, present in your visual cortex, but somehow it does not make it into consciousness at some moment. So this is the strategy. We are beginning to identify objective mechanisms of subjective processes, or what we call signatures of conscious processing, and the recipe has been to use visual illusions to make a stimulus visible or invisible at will, and then to track the fate of the stimulus in the brain. And I want to show you another illusion, perhaps you know this, to illustrate the idea that there is a lot of unconscious processing before we are conscious. We have an illusion of transparency of the world, so you have the illusion of seeing this checkerboard, and you don't realize that there is a problem here. What is the problem? The problem is that these two places are exactly the same. They have the same luminance, okay? Same gray level. But one is black, the other is white. So why is that? Well, your brain is computing the reflectance of the objects after subtracting the illuminant, okay? So the illuminant is here, the light coming from the right, and notice that there is a little bit of a shadow. We can barely see it. In fact, you probably were not conscious of the surrounding of the shadow here. But your brain subtracts out the shadow and lets you see one object as lighter than its luminance and the other as darker. Okay. So once again, these are exactly identical. So what this means is that what we are conscious of is the result of a first wave of early unconscious processing. And conscious perception relates to a very late process, after something like 300 milliseconds, one-third of a second, where the information becomes available to a larger network. And so the first message is the depth of unconscious processing. There is enormous amounts of unconscious processing. Virtually every processor in the brain can be unconscious. And this is just a sample of data where we have flashed, for instance, an unconscious word by making it subliminal. And the subliminal word can reach into the brain and reach even to the level of meaning, to the level of a decision, so on and so forth. And I would like to state very strongly that I think that in current artificial neural networks, we are modeling this unconscious part. In fact, there is a very good fit because these networks are feed-forward. So convolutional neural networks with their feed-forward nature capture quite well these unconscious operations where there is a sort of bottom-up stage. Okay. But there is more than that, of course, in the brain. And we have argued with my colleague Jean-Pierre Changeux and Lionel Nakache that we can propose a first hypothesis about conscious processing, which we call the global neuronal workspace. The idea is that, yes, there are many chains of unconscious processing in the brain, but there is another level, a second stage of representation, where what we experience, what we call being conscious, is in fact the global availability of information. And a philosopher, Daniel Dennett, has called this fame in the brain. One piece of information, which is shown in green here, makes it into this central stage, this set of processes that are interconnected with each other, that are evolved to select and to broadcast a piece of information, to make it available to the other processes. So allowing it in particular to be reported. So why do we associate consciousness with being able to report? Is because the information is available to the processes in the brain that are able to formulate the information verbally, in Broca's area in particular. But this is just one example. The information is in fact globally available. And in practical terms, in mechanical terms, it seems to correspond to the ignition of a distributed network of neurons, not in one area, but in multiple areas, because the goal is to broadcast information, but with prefrontal cortex in particular playing an important role. And there is top-down signaling, so the signal returns to many, many areas, including the ones that started the ignition. So there is anatomical evidence in support of this model. This is an analysis of anatomical networks in the primate brain by Henry Kennedy, suggesting that there is this sort of bottleneck with a lot of interconnected systems speaking to each other. There is also brain imaging evidence suggesting that if you contrast an unconscious on the right versus conscious stimulus, it can be a word, it can be a sound, you see this huge difference in the amplification of a signal. What's really fantastic about consciousness is you can flash something extremely briefly, like, you know, one fiftieth of a second. If you attend to it, you can grab it, and it will remain in your consciousness for as long as is needed to process it. This is the purpose of this system, to grab information and hold on to it, and it remains stable. So one way to see this is, in this recent experiment, we flash a lot of images, 9 per second, faces, houses. I think we can barely see here, I'm sorry, but imagine a stream of very fast images, 9 per second. We can use brain signals to decode each of these images. They go through the sensory system, and that's what you see with these diagonals here. But only one of them will be selected, and the one which is selected is amplified, and by about 370 milliseconds, you see this very strong amplification that has selected one object. And so we have to imagine the brain crisscrossed with many, many unconscious signals, but at some level there is one of them that dominates and becomes the object of conscious thought. I can show another example to convince you that this is really occurring at the level of physical neurons in the brain. It is possible now to begin to record from single neurons in the human brain in very rare cases of epilepsy patients. This is the work of Itzhak Fritz and collaborator Kuyan Quiroga in particular. And so you find neurons that are selective for one concept. For instance, this neuron here is selective for the concept of the World Trade Center, the old World Trade Center. And this neuron will not fire to other concepts, such as another building or another person. You will find neurons that code for Bill Clinton or for a particular actress, and so on and so forth, single neurons. Now, the beauty of this work here is that these neurons fire only when the person is conscious of the concept. So if you flash the picture too briefly, and this is shown in the red lines here. In the red lines, the image was flashed, But the person said, I didn't have time to see the picture. I don't know what it is. In these cases, the neuron does not fire. The neuron only fires when the person says, I have seen the picture, I know what it is, it's the World Trade Center. So these neurons, which fire at around 300, 400 milliseconds, seem to be selective for the conscious content of the subject. And here is another funnier example from recent work. Here you can make a morph of two people. This is actually a morph between Bob Marley and Whoopi Goldberg, for those of you who know the people in question, so you can sort of see it's in between. You can present the very same stimulus, and sometimes the person will say, I saw Whoopi Goldberg, that's on the right, and then the neuron will fire, because it's selective for that person. But if the person says, no, I saw Bob Marley, then the neuron does not fire. There is a complete correlation. You are right to say correlation is not causation, but there's a complete correlation between conscious perception of the person here and the firing of some of these late stable neurons. And the same in the monkey can be done. In the monkey, in fact, we can go a little bit further. And so this is one experiment recently where Peter Roofsemer in Amsterdam recorded the responses in three different areas, V1, V4, which are sensory visual areas, and also prefrontal cortex, and flashed a stimulus so that it could be sometimes perceived and sometimes not. What you see on the left is this sort of threshold curve, where if you make the stimulus more and more contrasted, there is a more and more higher probability for the monkey or the human to see the stimulus. And in the middle, you have these stimuli that are sometimes seen and sometimes missed. So the seen trials are in green, and the missed trials are in red here. And you can see two things. There can be a lot of firing to an unconscious stimulus, the missed trials in red. So in the early visual areas, there is really no correlate of consciousness at this moment, or no strong correlate of consciousness, because the processing can go on unconsciously, even if the monkey does not report seeing the stimulus. But in the prefrontal cortex, completely different. Prefrontal cortex ignites whenever there is a report of seeing the stimulus. You can see in red that they might begin to fire. I don't know if I can point. They might begin to fire in red, but then they fail. And we call this failed ignition. You can see that at the end, the system separates into really two very well separated states, conscious, not conscious. And even if there is an illusion, there are some trials of false alarms. They are in blue here, where there was no stimulus, but the monkey says, I think I saw one. Then you can see the neurons fire. So there's very good correlation between this late ignition and the consciousness. So these data also begin to answer the question, what could be the function of consciousness? There are some philosophers that say that consciousness could be a simple epiphenomenon, because there is so much unconscious processing. But I don't believe that this is the right conclusion from this work. For this work suggests that there is an actual function of consciousness to reflect upon the information beyond the first half second. In the first half second, we can have unconscious processing, but beyond that, we need consciousness to be able to hold onto the information to make it stable, to route this information to other processing stages, perform chains of operation, breaking the modularity, passing information across modules, and to monitor behavior. This is what in the paper I gave we call C2, this ability to self-reflect. And in particular, in this experimental work here, we've shown that you need to be conscious of the stimulus in order to know if you have made an error. There is a rather extraordinary signal in the brain that detects when we make an error, completely from inside. It's a beautiful machine, I would say. There is no feedback from the external world, but if you click the wrong button, sometimes at the very time that you do it, you know that you are wrong. You know that you make an error. Well, at that time, the prefrontal cortex generates this enormous called error negativity, which you can see on the screen here. But it does so only if there was consciousness of the original stimulus. If you are not aware of the stimulus, you cannot access to the second level, which is reflective, which is, I know that I made an error. So we can begin to analyze in this very elementary sense a notion of self, self-reflection. I know that I was wrong. It's very rudimentary, I think. We need very simple paradigms, but it's the beginning of it. And there is similar work on the self, awareness of the body, for instance, awareness of where are my limbs, or is this part of my body or not, and so on and so forth. So I'd like to finish by going back to the machines very tentatively, because I know that there are experts in this room about what machines can do and what machines cannot do yet. But I'd like to suggest a number of arguments for what could be missing in the current machines. And the first thing is this idea of global availability, which the brain has, the human brain certainly, and probably many other animals. The idea is that if you take a machine like the iPhone on the left, you have many intelligent apps, but they don't speak to each other. So one program may know a piece of information, but the rest of the system is not informed about this information. So for instance, one piece of software has a map of Rome. There is a whole map of Rome in this at the moment, but the other apps don't know about this information. And I think what the brain has is a way to share the information, to break this modularity, a system that passes information, of course not all information, but just the one which is relevant for the organism, passes it to the other systems. I don't see why it should be impossible to do that in machines, but I don't think it's being done or not to the same level at this moment. Second reflection is, if you need to do that, you need to have, at the C2 level, the monitoring level, you need to have a repertoire of self-knowledge. The machine seems to know what it knows, okay? Know what module it possesses, know what goals they can fulfill, so the cartography system can point me in the right direction, how fast they can operate, what is the likelihood that they are to be correct, and humans seem to have exactly that. For instance, even in young children, when they start to calculate, if you give them a 3-digit problem, they will say, I cannot do it. If you give them a 1-digit problem, they will say, well, I have a number of options, I can count on my fingers, I can call my memory, and they will select the appropriate option based on what they know that they know. So they have this repertoire of knowledge. So my argument is that we should have this sort of knowledge in a machine if we want to call them conscious. Some kind of database which is constantly updated of what the machine can or cannot do. So we can say it's a sort of know thyself. Again, I don't see any impossibility, but I also don't think that current machines do this. I would like to know if they do it. And this leads us to this notion of confidence. You also have to know that you don't know. And human brains are remarkable at knowing that they don't know. So even monkeys or even preverbal infants, for instance, you look a little child, and there are beautiful experiments by Sid Quider in particular in Paris, even a very young child will be able to ask for help. Asking for help implies that you have realized the limits of your own knowledge and that you realize that somebody else has the knowledge. So again, a machine could potentially be equipped by a number of interesting devices here. First of all, perhaps Bayesian programs, statistical programs that know the probability of being right. Do not always think that they're right, but have a probability attached to their answers. And also that have this error detection system that predicts if the current behavior is likely to be right or wrong. And coupling between error detection and search, because when we detect an error, we also try to solve the problem. So there is some architecture for doing this in the human brain. The last point I will mention, still in this domain of self-monitoring, which I think is still mysterious in the brain, is there is something particular to humans, not available, I think, to any other primate. And what seems to be available is the capacity to represent at a higher level what other people are thinking, what we call theory of mind. This is one of the dimensions in which we are very different. So we distinguish what we know, I know X, what other people know, the other person knows X, but also I know that this other person knows X, and I know that this other person does not know X, and so on and so forth. It can be completely recursive. And this doesn't seem to be readily available to other primates. I think it's a very important aspect of human knowledge to maximize the usefulness of information we communicate to each other. So we all have GPSs that will repeat 3 times at the roundabout text the 3rd exit. I think we've all experienced that. This is not very relevant knowledge, where what it really means is turn left, right? And there is no reason also to repeat it. So I am tired of these machines that don't take into account the state of mind of their users and just you know, blindly, unconsciously deliver a sort of stimulus here. But I think we can imagine machines that would actually be much better support for the human, because they would take into account the knowledge of the human as well as the knowledge of the machine. That requires a machine that is, in a certain sense, aware of its own abilities. And just to conclude, I think, first of all, I really think that in this line of work, we see consciousness as a computational property associated with certain types of information processing, but therefore not inaccessible to machines, even if they are not made of flesh or of neurons. I also think that machine consciousness will not emerge spontaneously. This idea of a singularity where suddenly the internet becomes conscious, I think is ridiculous. I think we need careful engineering if this is to be achieved. It will not come spontaneously. It will be a feat of engineering. And I have to say, throughout my talk, I left completely out the idea whether this is desirable. I think we should discuss that during this meeting. I'm not sure if it is desirable, but I think it is possible. Thank you.